Hey, what's going on, guys? It's Wookie again. Just, again, kind of, I know last week I told you I was splitting this episode into two, and I just kind of wanted to kind of reintroduce that for maybe somebody who didn't listen to last week's. Last week's episode was a one-parter, but it was tough. It was almost 2 hours long, so I decided to chop it down into two equal bits. If you want the full thing, listen to last week's episode first, and then listen to this week's episode. Otherwise, they're pretty evergreen, so you're not going to miss anything. But do listen to last week's episode. We get into a little mass mutation discussion and kind of what we think about the set. And I'm sure next week we're going to get into even more now that we've had some opportunities to play this set. I'm not sure at the time of me recording this if it's going to be available on Crucible yet or not. We'll have to wait and see on that one. But, you know, hopefully it is. Hopefully it's out there and people are already playing it. We're going to get some in-person games going for Archon's Corner. You know, obviously three of us live in the same area, so we're going to meet up and play a little bit. So hopefully we can get some better ideas of what this set's all about. I want to thank everybody for everybody's continued support during coronavirus and all that kind of stuff. So you guys are fantastic. You're wonderful. I wish I could hug and kiss every one of you. That's not possible right now for more reasons than one. But next time we're at a vault tour, absolutely come on, say hi, and we'll get this thing going for you guys. All right, take care. So give me the green light, 'cause I'm ready to go. It was at Indy. You three know exactly what it is. I'm not going to go into it. I will say the one thing, if there is anything ever a time you are ever uncomfortable with ever at a vault tour, you do need to stop everything and call a judge. Like, no matter what.
Yeah.
Like, if you're uncomfortable, you need to stop, call a judge, figure the situation out there and then, instead of letting it continue into a situation that gets really, really, really super duper awkward. So that's all I'm going to say. I'm not going to continue to go into it. Those of you at Indy probably know what it is. I know that these three do and some other people do, but I don't want to bring it. I don't want to open up old wounds. So let's see. Do you guys still hate?
Hold on one second. Because I also want to second that. I mean, we can't hit that enough. There have been at least two other events that I have had, and they were not as bad as what happened to you, Wookie. But one happened for Shadow Worlds, and one happened in an actual Vault Tour. If you don't feel comfortable, if something is not right, call a judge. I feel bad each time. I mean, honestly, it's feel bad of like, should I call a judge? If you have even an inkling, I'm going to tell you should call a judge. And I'll say that because it's just much easier to get it sorted out earlier than later.
Yeah, especially on time-related issues, which not all of these are about, but time-related issues is a hard one to make that decision of, am I being a jerk complaining about how slow this dude's playing, or is this a legitimate problem? It's not really it's somewhat your choice to make, but ultimately there are rules regarding people spending too long taking their turns, and judges are supposed to deal with it.
The problem is that it comes across as very, like, I see this as a casual game.
It doesn't seem friendly.
It doesn't seem friendly. And as soon as you do it, it changes the dynamic for the game. But the end result is it also changes the dynamic. And those are the games that stick with me of like, why didn't you? Because when you have someone who plays one card to go ahead, they're playing to time and then play that card, that's also wrong. That is straight up wrong, and we need to get something different for our going to time rules. Yeah. I don't wish that it happened, but we need to be able to look at that. Wookie, the other question I would have is, what about Collinsville and the idea of your ability to play? Is that something that, like, didn't you have the ability to play at Collinsville versus record?
I did. That is a regret of mine, because there was a time... This is such a long story. Yeah. There was a time where Archon's Corner was looked at to become the casters of vaults. I had chosen at that time, along with the team that we had, that, you know, hey, I'm going to be the one that's going to sit down. I'm going to be the one to do commentary as opposed, because, you know, this was a big opportunity for us. I'm going to be the one, I'm going to choose to do commentary as opposed to actually play. And that's happened on a couple of occasions. And then nothing came of it. So, do I regret it? There's parts of me that say yes and parts of me that say no. Because let's say, you know, obviously there, we're in the situation we are where it just didn't work out the way that it was going to. Yeah, that was a regret that I had didn't play in those events. But like, let's say it goes the opposite direction. Well, then, now it's the best decision I've ever made in my life. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it's one of those things where I view it. It's the past. It is what it is. I wish I could have played at Collinsville. I didn't get the opportunity. It is what it is. We went 4-0 in team, so whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah, we crushed it in team. So do you still hate AOA, or have you come to the conclusion it's the best set ever?
Have I converted you guys?
No.
Thanks, Chief.
This wasn't Dan. This person actually specifically asked me to put it in there that he wanted to remain in. I left everybody anonymous, but he specifically did not want his name in any of this, which I, whatever, that's fine. I'm never going to call somebody out that doesn't want to be. Nobody has converted me on AOA yet. I understand still to this day, maybe AOA hasn't gotten a fair shake, but at the same time, like, AOA still hasn't won a vault tour. I understand we haven't had any vault tours since, what, March or February? Do we have one in February?
Wasn't that Dallas?
Was that Dallas?
I think so.
I'm not sure, but okay, so it hasn't had that opportunity. Well, guess what? Neither did Worlds Collide. Literally has the shortest shelf life of Vault Tour availability, and it is still 1-1.
Yep.
Two. So, for one. Me, debating just on a one? Set...
What? It was in the finals for another Albany, but it won in Philly.
What's that? I'm sorry. You're confused.
Worlds Collide. It won a Vault Tour, the very first Archon Vault Tour since it was released.
Yep.
And then it came in second in the most recent Vault Tour survival.
So, do I feel like I've been unfair to AOA? No.
My knock on AOA is this. This game is a game. It is about having fun. It's about sitting down and having a good experience. If I'm sitting in a sealed event and it's AOA, I'm getting three decks. Even at three decks, there's a very good chance I'm getting going to play a deck that has little to no amber control or little to no creature control or very minimal amber gain. It's going to have a weakness because across the board, AOA decks, unless they have a very specific set of cards, are failing to do an entire part of the game in most decks. This is how they were built. It's just the cards in the set.
Yeah. We all know Dan loves AOA.
I think that it gets exacerbated as a result of coming right after Coda. And so all of the different flaws that Z just talked about are really showcased when you play against Coda. Now seeing AOA against Worlds Collide, I mean, I'm excited to be able to see it even brought into Mass Mutations and played against it. I think that it's a slower game. I think that all those issues exist. I think there's some great decks that are out there, but I don't think overall it was a good second set and that it helped the game. So no, I have not been pushed over. I enjoy some of the AOA decks, but that's about as far as I'm going to go on that.
I mean, I still know people that quit during that time that never came back. So, I mean, that sucks. Right? Like, AOA definitely was not a good phase of the game.
All right. During Shadow Worlds, your team was called the Grump Buggy Brewers. Why? I didn't name the team. I don't know who did that. Dan, JR, you guys, you named the team.
That's JR, a friend of ours, John, and myself. That's the team name we had been running for the COAT events. And John was going to go to Worlds with us when Worlds was still a thing, but he wasn't able to play in Shadow Worlds, so then we got you instead.
Yeah, I was second choice, second fiddle.
Well, Well, let's be very honest about what happened there. John literally got called into work. He works sometimes some second shift, or is it third shift? He was working over the night.
He works all sorts of shifts, but
yeah. He has done vault tours in that state, but it has impacted him. And so he could not go ahead and play right before Shadow Worlds. And I think we found out, was it 2 or 3 days before?
So, closer to a week, but yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it was a few days before, and Wookie, you were going to be going and playing for a different team at Worlds, but then that also, because of Shadow Worlds and who was there, that meant that you were open. And so with our local, we wanted to, one, you're a great player, two, you're someone who's local, and we wanted to keep it kind of in that frame.
Sure.
So, yeah, our name is, I'm Grumpy. So Grump Buggies was, I don't know. It's just a good thing. And then we're Wisconsin. Our state baseball team is the Brewers. It just sort of works. JR and I are both home brewers. So it kind of just captures a bunch of words that represent us and our team. And it's catchy enough.
Funny you should mention that you're home brewers, because somebody also asked, I understand you, JR and Dan, are home brewers. What kind of beers do you guys typically brew, and do you have any suggestions for a first timer?
Yeah.
So in brewing, it's a KISS approach. When you start off, it's keep it simple. Don't try to make the 15 flavor edition dark beer with 10 different malts in it. You want to pick some kind of pale ale IPA. You want it to have 3 or 4 grains at most. 1 or 2 hops at most, and just keep it simple. The more you add, the more complex it gets. And then the other side is cleaning. Got to keep everything really clean.
And I would start with the infamous piece of relax and have a homebrew. Really be relaxed. Don't overstress. It's not supposed to be something that is going to amp you up. You know, if you can go ahead and meet up with someone who's in your local area who's brewed before, that really helps. But I think that going ahead and doing extract, and honestly, home brewing is about what you like. So for me, I like hoppy beers. So that's what I brew. I mean, I have a big deep freezer that I've converted to a 4-tap kegerator system. So I have right now a local Weiss beer from my wife. And then I have 2 hoppy beers, one from homegrown hops, and then 2 with quite a bit of Citra and Citra and Galaxy, and just hops. Out of 5 gallons, we're looking at well over a pound of hops. And so that's a very, very high rate. Most of it came very, very late. And it's a hazy IPA is what it is right now, but it is absolutely delicious. So with homebrewing, 1, sanitation, as Dan said, and then 2, just, you know, do what you want. If you want to go ahead and do a lager, then do a lager. If you want to do a red ale, do a red ale. You know, find something that you want, because that's the whole benefit. I'm going to tell you that as Dan and I have been doing this for quite a while. Sorry, Dan, we're getting old, man. But what was available for craft brew when we first started was okay. But it has really improved lately. I don't know if I would go ahead and be into the hops as much as I am with what's out there and available right now. But that's where it is. I also have a number of sours. So I love some of the sour beer. And we had a couple different barrel projects that were going on. So again, do what you like. Keep it clean on the clean side. And relax and have a homebrew.
All right. Last beer question. And this is for everyone. What is your favorite beer? And what is your least favorite beer? We're going to start with Z because he's been quiet. Z, are you a beer drinker number one?
I don't drink alcohol.
Oh, Z doesn't. That's right. You don't drink alcohol.
I was right. I was guessing. Somebody in the chat asked, you know, pick a drink for everybody. I don't know if you put that question in.
I did.
And I just said, okay. So then I won't put my answers in.
Okay.
And I totally respect that. I have no issues with that at all. So all the better for you, Z. Yeah. That's awesome.
So then, JR, what's your favorite beer and what is your least favorite beer?
Well, let's start with the least favorite beer. That's going to be a tack on our good buddy, Mech Bunny there with some Miller Lite. hometown. But we joke about that as being water, and that's the result. I just don't like it because it doesn't have flavor. It's fine for what it really is, but I'm looking for having one beer, maybe two, and I want it to be flavorful. So that is where I like to go ahead and push. I suppose they want something that's going to be commercial.
I was kind of figuring they'd meant commercialize. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, for me, I'm going with my hop beer. Outside of that, I have to go with the flavor, the consistent piece. Pseudo Sioux just consistently is up there as a great craft beer that I really enjoy. And I have no problem having it whenever it's on tap or when it's available. I don't know if everyone knows what Pseudo Sioux is.
No.
Pseudo Sioux is a big hoppy, it's a Galaxy dry hopped pale ale, and it's coming from a brewery that was originally out of Iowa, and that's Toppling Goliath. They're pretty well known now, but it's got some really, really good, we'll go with some, the fruitiness that comes through from the hops is very, very, very enjoyable. There's a bit of dryness, but I get some dark fruit. I definitely go ahead and we'll get quite a bit of flavor that comes from it. So I enjoy that.
Dan, least favorite and most favorite?
Most commonly bought beer for me, which I rarely buy the same beer twice, is just Zombie Dust from Three Floyds, which is a straight Citra hop pale ale. Good beer. Worst beers is anything Belgian. So the Belgians took German beers and then they put it in their hot, stanky basements and ruined it. And people still drink it today. And I don't understand it.
Because it's great.
Because it is wretched, awful stuff. Can't drink them. I'm too sensitive to all the phenolic off flavors in them.
I don't know. You really liked your rock beer that we had. Smoked beer. Dan has we went through BJCP training, which is beer judge training. Dan does not like smoked beer at all.
Yep. It's fair like enough. Licking a burnt tire.
So my favorite beer is Golden Drock. It is a Belgian ale, which means that Dan hates it immediately.
Actually, that is one of the least repulsive Belgians out there.
I like it. I've said this a time or two before. It's got to be the tri-ruple, not the quadruple. White bottle, not black bottle. It's just the black bottle, just derived of all flavor. There's no flavor in it whatsoever. So I go with that. And my least favorite beer is any Saison. Which unfortunately our beer tastes don't line up at all. Cause I know you like the sour Saisons.
Saisons. Yes. Saisons are the biggest, disaster of beer ever made.
I hate them. I had one and I poured, I think, half of it out cause it was disgusting.
I will go in that I don't like the barnyard component from sours. So I'm more of, I don't like barnyard. I'll go with that.
All right. Let's get away from beer for a little bit, from drinking for a little bit. We'll come back to some drinks in a minute. I'm going to answer this one real quick because I thought about this one and I've come up with a decision. Somebody asks, I know you're big into wrestling. What is the best wrestling to watch right now? And I will tell you, if you have the ability to watch the Access Network, find out what time New Japan Pro Wrestling is on. That is the best wrestling, bar none, that's happening right now. WWE is trash. AEW is even worse. Forget Impact because it's not even worth your time. And anything from England, just stay away from because who knows how long those guys are going to be around with all the, quote unquote, rape allegations that are out there. So we don't know how long those guys are even going to be there. And it's just kind of icky. So I would say New Japan Pro Wrestling right now is probably the best that's going on at the current time. All right, let's get back into Keyforge. What are some things on the prize wall that you didn't see that you think would be good additions And what are some things that you would like to never see again? And I'm actually going to start this one. One thing I would like to see that Magic does is giant oversized cards. We're not talking like the oversized cards you see in Walmart for Pokemon and whatnot. These are like half a person. Giant oversized cards. I think those could be really fun to put up on a wall in your game room or something as to that. Not posters, oversized cards. Like I actually would probably spend shards on those. They might be a little tricky to take home with you, I guess, but somehow Magic players have found a way to do it for years, so I think that would be cool. I have a few things like posters, playmat. Well, how do you guys feel about playmats on the
I think they deserve to be there.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of us already have them, but I mean, many people enjoy them. I don't know. I think they're properly placed.
There's something that I actually, you know, I bought one, and so it's something I spent amber shards on, and I'm fine with. There are other things that I would not spend money, amber shards on at all. So I like that they're there.
All right. So what are those things you wouldn't spend amber shards on at all?
Well, we already.
Boxes,
wooden keys.
Yeah, the wooden tokens are pretty unspectacular.
The ones that look like I could snap in half with
one. Yeah, hand. That is a problem. But posters, things of that nature, I'd say, yeah. I'm okay going away.
On your poster thought, on previous times, I have grumped about how pathetic the prize support is for winning a vault tour.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, like, it's something, but you get more out of winning a grand championship, really, for certain, actually. Mm-hmm. But on your thing, instead of it being a poster, what I want is an uncut sheet of the deck I won with.
Oh, that'd be pretty nasty.
That's what I want to put, like an uncut sheet of my deck for my wall.
Foil.
I think that would be pretty cool.
Foiled out.
Yeah, you foil it all you want. All
right.
But yeah. I think, I mean, like, because you can't reprint the decks, because that totally breaks what the game is supposed to be. So I don't even really want a gold-bordered version of it. But if, you know, like, I think an uncut one to put on the wall would be really cool.
That is something I would, yeah, I'd like that. That'd be nifty. I dig it.
I think a phone case would be cool with like some of the card art.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, okay. Keyforge phone cases or something as to that nature. I mean, I still think the best purchase I've ever made at the Vault Tour was the bag. I think that bag was just like absolutely fantastic.
Maybe too.
I'm not an iPhone user, so I don't support phone cases.
Oh yeah, they'd have to have Samsung and all that jazz, but
I don't have a Samsung.
Okay, well, sorry. I don't know what else to tell you. That would be a kind of a thing that would be, I guess, kind of difficult because everyone's got different phones. I mean, iPhones and Samsungs are the most popular, so that would probably be the ones they choose.
More likely to see pop sockets because they're generic.
Pop sockets, yeah. I mean, I'd even go for a pop socket though.
I don't have one of those either.
I don't know if I'd use it, but I know my kids would at least use it, or somebody would use it, you know.
Yeah, I wouldn't get one, but I think the pop sockets would be a good idea. Actually, I already talked to Josh about that. I know they were talking about it at one point. So maybe they did order it for this year.
I think those drink carriers that Alex was talking about many moons ago now. Remember those? We talked about like the drink clamps on the on the tables. I think those would be fantastic. I would definitely get one of those. I mean, I bought one just for me, like at my house. So why wouldn't I buy also a Keyforge one with like my favorite house on them? I think those would be a great addition as well. So, but that's me.
I would like to see them continue the house specific clothing line. I mean, I was not a Brobnar, nor am I a music person, so the Brobnar band didn't do it for me, but I did get some of the Saurian stuff because I thought that was pretty cool, and I would definitely get some sweet demon art on my t-shirt.
Yeah, that'd be kind of nifty.
Like an archivist shirt.
Zenzic
shirt.
Something like that, yeah.
So
I'd go for that, though.
For me, I'm a pin person, and so I actually really like the Bad Penny Source Rex. So having some of those specialty pins really goes ahead and kind of appeals to me. I'm also thinking when we're looking, Sheep actually takes his vault pins and plugs them into his playmat. Mm-hmm. I'd like to honestly see, it's a clip. Think of like a money clip that would just go on the outside. So instead of being able to pierce right through your playmat, you could have something that would represent it's coming from that vault that would just clip on the outside. Mm. If it's usable and it's going to somehow show chains or somehow go ahead and show what your houses are, or, you know, if it had some playability piece that makes it even better. And then I'd also put out a face mask. I think right now happening, that it would be great to have some Keyforge face mask to be able to represent the game, and whether that's at a vault tour, that's at a chainbound, or just honestly when we're going out into public, because that's what's going to be needed.
I still would like to see something top 8, top 16, top 4, getting some, like for vault tours, getting something that says here's where I place. I mean, because we must be honest, top 32, top 16. Winning, yeah. I mean, these are all things that are, these are pretty decent sized accomplishments. You know, like, and I think they should be placed. You know, hey, I placed. Magic has had them for years. Pokemon has them. Yu-Gi-Oh, you know, all the majors have something saying I placed here. You know, and I think that's a big deal.
I really think what that is the first Vault Tours were launched without a ton of prep, I would say. And then what they did is they didn't want to change the prize support during the middle of the first season, because then the early people get grumpy. So I think we will see a change to prize structure when Afterworld season 2 would have started, but who knows when that'll ever happen now.
Dan, you're 10th. I didn't know.
Yeah.
Oh. Nice.
I was going to say overall. All right. So, okay. So here's one. What is your opinion on the current chair situation?
What chairs? There are no chairs.
Exactly.
We have not seen any chairs. We know of no chairs. There are no chairs.
Well,
no
this chairs. Is, if there's a Ponzi scheme to be had in shards, it's chairs. I think they're this 10x shard thing. We're all gonna get 10x shards, and then in maybe a few months, when we can't ever go to events still, they're gonna open up a digital prize wall, and it's gonna have masks on it, and they're gonna be like 400 amber shards. It's gonna be something stupid. Like I don't know how things cannot inflate hugely with this 10x thing. I mean, one box is 120 shards, which is more than a lot of people have ever had.
Right.
Yeah, when I saw that, I was like, well, my 3,000 mean nothing now.
Well, yeah, because the question is that right now we're sitting here and we've seen a couple updates from people that have gone out and said, I'm getting chairs, was that they were going through a provider, and then due to COVID, the provider shut down. How true that is, I don't know. But that provider was no longer available, so then now they needed a new chair provider. Again, how true that is, I don't know.
I would believe that if the first chair wasn't ordered in August of last year.
Yeah.
Was it August last year already?
Yes.
I thought it was even earlier than that. I thought it was July of last year.
It was in August.
I know that from what I read, the recent piece from Dave Cordero was that, you know, organized play was very, very frustrated about it. And so I at least need to give them that I don't think it's in their control. I really hope that it's not in their control. And they're trying to be able to reach out to the people, at least to Dave, about it. So it's a big bummer. It's kind of a little black eye on organized play there, but it is what it is at this point. Chairs are, the chair that I saw was the spray painted chair with the chain tracker card placed over it as we wait for any deal there.
All right.
I think this is probably a budgeting issue where whoever the bean counter or the prize developer is, you know, they're like, it was this many shards, so that means you're supposed to keep this chair at costing us this number of dollars, and they're finding they can't do that and have a custom stitching done.
Well, that was Josh.
Josh?
Okay. Josh was in charge of pricing.
Can I go ahead and say, well, Z, I feel bad with the 3,000 shards and, you know, kind of the situation. I think they're trying to jumpstart the game after COVID really destroying organized play. And so I give them credit that they're trying to do something with the new set to try and get people into the game and to say, hey, play. I don't know if it'll work. We'll have to see. But yeah, it does hurt all those people who've had quite a bit of Amber Shards. That's
my biggest question right now is they said there's going to be chain bound events are what time are times 10 too? Is that right or no? They said there was something going to be done with chain bound.
So there is another number that really matters for this. So right now, say, and I'm just saying, if there were 1 million Amber Shards handed out to this point, but only 60,000 redeemed, it doesn't really matter that they're doing a 10x because the percentage that are going to get redeemed is still going to be so low.
Right.
So there, I mean, there are some metrics that we don't know anything about.
Well, this is a problem we've been talking about for forever.
Yeah, who knows how deep their prize pit is? They may have 12 billion Amber Shards worth of prizes sitting in a pit that they haven't been able to get rid of, and they're like, well, the stuff is old, we can't do anything with it, let's just give away a bunch of Amber Shards, give it away, and move on.
All right, here's the dreaded question. Pick a drink for everyone. Let's start with Dan. Dan, pick a drink for your co-hosts here.
Well, I nailed it. I said Z was getting a Coke. JR, yep. It's like, what have I actually seen him drink? JR is most definitely getting an IPA. Because it's simple. And then I would probably be real nasty to Wookiee because that's the kind of person I am. And he'd get like some Mountain Dew with grenadine in it or something. Just something that would make you want to yak.
Sure, Shirley Temple.
Oh, his Shirley Temple, yes. That was my other plot. But if we're getting drunk, he's getting Mountain Dew with something just wretched in it. Mountain Dew and vermouth. Oh, that'd be good. We'll call it the Dutini.
Do these all have to be alcoholic?
No.
All right, so good.
They said pick a drink. They didn't say pick an alcoholic drink.
I'm aware. I'm just double checking.
You so you down, Wookiee? Will you drink my Dutini I make you?
Your Dutini? What's in a Dutini?
It's going to be Mountain Dew and vermouth for sure.
Oh. Maybe. What else?
I haven't figured it out.
Is it gin or vodka?
It'd be gin, no, and it would have olives.
Then no. Absolutely not if it's gin.
All right. Z, Wookiee, who's going next?
All right. So, why do... Never mind. Trying to think. Well, JR is definitely the hop crazy. What is that beer that I always see that I go blah 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 in the store? What is it? Hopping Mad or something like that, where it's supposed to have like five times the hops of any other beer on a market or something like that.
Yes, please.
Yeah, that's definitely JR. I always picture, you know, it's funny. I know Dan's a beer guy. I always pictured Dan as a whiskey guy.
Rum.
I was thinking whiskey, like a higher end, but not like up at the top whiskey. Z is just a water guy. Z likes the water. I always see him filling up his bottle at every vault tour, like 100 times.
Between every round,
he just goes, fills up his
water. Even when people try to like derail me on my way to the bathroom to fill my water.
And I was blocking him left and right. Like you're not getting around me, dude.
Right in the way. Like, okay, guy.
Z, what do you got?
Hey, I'm going to say that the water piece is, we've heard this a couple times coming from Lady Aurora. It is one of the best strategies that really does help you to be focused, take a little break, stay hydrated during the vault tour.
I've said it in multiple casts between every round. I go fill up my water and I go pee because I'm drinking so much damn water. But like, that's an important part of my process.
Sorry. What happened? What helped me at Adepticon last year? Bought a 6-pack of NOS.
I'm going to jump in here because that's what I had. I actually had Dan running with rum. And I had you Wookiee with an energy drink. And Z, I don't know you as well as the others, so I went with, okay, you're down in Texas, and yep. I went with sweet iced tea. I mean, with sweet tea. I can't imagine anyone down south yep. not being in sweet tea.
I had a big old glass yesterday.
All right. Sure. There we go.
Yeah, energy drinks like for rum. Me for sure. Or nitro brew coffee from Starbucks.
Also,
the stuff with the cream on the top?
It's got like a foam, I guess. I don't know. It doesn't have like whipped cream. No, it's got like foam.
No, they got their cold brew, yeah. caramel cream, whatever. And it's just about drinking the sweet cream on top. Yeah.
No, man, I want what's underneath that. I like extraordinarily bitter coffee. So that's me.
And you don't like West Coast IPA?
No.
How do you?
It's I know it's strange, but I like my coffee to bite back. I don't want my liquor to bite me back, though. I know that's weird, but it is what it is.
See, what does Z think that we're all going to be drinking?
Oh, yeah, Z. I forgot about Z.
I say we just sit around, play some Key Forward, drink some root beer.
Root beer is great.
Bark's got bite. That's the best one.
Bark's got bite. Okay, so we're going to go through these. I know, JR, you got to scoot, so I don't know if any of these are going to pertain to you. Actually, this one will, so I'll ask it real quick. Have you opened any nutty mass mutation decks thus far?
What do you mean? Nutty just in fun? Yeah, there's some great stuff. Actually, one that I pulled out yesterday had Orb of Wonder with Ducilus. So another way to be able to cycle, I gave my wife that deck just to play. It was fun. Honestly, she cycled it through twice, and I had to kill it off with standardized testing and what is it? The Saurian card, something but too many. What is it?
You're not talking about Isles, are you?
No. Isles is really, really difficult to go ahead and actually pull off, especially when people have an even amount of cards in their battle line. No, I'll go and look for it. Totally blanking here. But that was a lot of fun. I also had, I think, Sanctum with Saurian and Senator Brackus was a lot of fun when I can go ahead and have Lieutenant Gorvinol go ahead and capture, and then I can go ahead and use Brackus for what's there. Those are two decks right now that I've just been having a lot of fun with. They're not super competitive, but from what I've pulled, I'm definitely enjoying that.
Let's see, Dan, I think you're the only one that has decks right now. So anything exceptionally nutty?
I mean, Sass. The Sass metric really likes one I opened, and it's got triple shoulder ID in it and triple rad penny. So that's definitely a thing.
Loves rad penny.
Yeah,
like a lot.
Yeah,
good of the many was the other card that I used to destroy. Okay. Yeah, it was great. It's not a dino, and my wife was extremely upset that it's not a dino.
Desolus?
Yeah.
Oh, he's probably just a beast, isn't he?
Yes, he is.
Yeah. And a mutant because he's big.
Or mutant beast. Yeah. So then I'm going to get into kind of the more obscure questions. So JR can kind of boot scoot whenever he needs, because I know he's got a scoot here in a minute.
I got 2 minutes.
Yeah. So whenever you need, just kind of go, whatever. Because these are all kind of, some of them are Dan's questions posed to me, and I'll answer them. And a lot.
Dan had an intoxicated run. Yeah. One of the dailies. He came back from a great barbecue party, and he definitely listed. One of those was JR, will you marry me? Because yep. I asked him to be cut off. So I love my wife and I am taken, Dan. So I'm sorry. Many spoons will happen in the future, but
I was trying to find that one because there was a good, he had some multiple good little runs, but that was one of the better ones, but I couldn't find that one in the chat for whatever reason. Like I had to scroll way back. And I just, for whatever reason, couldn't find them. But, one big question that was posed to me, and this happened multiple times. Why am I playing Pokemon? Am I quitting Keyforge? The answer is no to quitting Keyforge. I'm still going to be playing Keyforge. I just bought 2 boxes of Mass Mutation, and I'll probably end up buying more because that's the way the world works when you're the Wookiee. You buy 2, and then you go, man, I need more. And then, like, you just keep buying them until there are no more left in Wisconsin. And then you go, where am I going to get more Keyforge? Dan's got it worse than I do. Dan just every time he's like, $40 boxes, give me 10. And just keeps buying them. So I'm playing Pokemon due to my children wanting to play Pokemon. I tried to get them into Keyforge. They just honestly, they weren't interested. And during COVID, all 2 of them, Livy's a little too young, wanted Pokemon. So I said, that's fine. Let's play some Pokemon. Went out, grabbed a couple starters, started playing online. It was just something different at the time and, you know, just was playing. It was nothing really, honestly. Other than that, we've still been playing. The kids still love it. So. They want to go to the big tournaments like Dad does with the Vault Tour, so we'll see how that goes. But that's kind of the Keyforge aspect of it. And what is the best video game right now?
Hold on 1 second. I want to go and interject real fast. I have a 7-year-old. That's my oldest. And she is kind of in the opposite. Instead of Pokemon, she loves Keyforge. So what we've been playing, because I've just been cracking some Mass Mutation decks, is I gave her the deck, and then we played a 1 key. And that kept it focused for a 7-year-old, so it doesn't drag on forever. And it also gives me a little bit of rep to just continue to shuffle cards and see some of the new cards.
Yeah.
So all the dads out there, I recommend, even if you have a little one, I mean, my 7-year-old, she's a smart, smart girl. So she can handle the numbers. We're still working a little bit on what some of the different actions, and you know, it's a great chance to read, but use any chance with a game, whether that's Pokemon, whether that's Keyforge, get your kids into. It may not be a full game, don't expect that, but honestly, her focus can be longer. She wants to always play longer, and this is what we need to get some of these kids in. So,
and that's kind of what we've been doing with Pokemon too. They don't have, so you're supposed to play it to like 6 prizes. Sophie will, Jamie will not, so we play it to 3. You know, we cut it in half, so. It is what it is. That's actually a really good idea. I didn't even think about just playing to 1 key and kind of going from there, or even like 2 keys, just kind of chopping it down and doing it a little bit different. So,
and then I wanted to take a quick moment to sign off and say, everyone stay safe, enjoy Mass Mutations, and hopefully we'll be able to see you out again in the real world with some sweet mass. Good luck with the rest of the show, guys.
All right. We'll see you later, JR. All right, and then we're going to go into this. Somebody asked me what's the best video game to play right now. Obviously, I've been doing a lot of video games, been doing a lot of stream with the video games. Right now, I'm playing Valorant a lot. I was playing Modern Warfare. That game's trash. I like Valorant. Number one, it's free to play, so it's not even like other free to play games where like that's you buy it or you download it and then you have to buy all this stuff. Everything in it's cosmetics, so. Being free and everything else being cosmetic, I really enjoyed it. So I'm playing Valorant a lot. Last real question, and then we'll get into some of Dan's craziness. Is there anything about the podcast you wish you could change? I'll start with Z. Is there anything you want to change? Is there anything you wish you could have changed from way back when? Maybe change it now?
I think we did it. I think we could have used more people. From way back, more consistently, and we've added some really good personalities, and I think we're moving forward. Right now, we just need more actual events to talk about, but we don't have that much control right. over that. We are doing the dailies. I think we're doing a good job with that. I think we've addressed what I thought we needed way back when.
So I really don't. I would I have changed anything? No. And I know what he's alluding to. No, I wouldn't have changed anything. I know a lot of people think the negativity on the show, it's not about the negativity, and I've said it so many times. I like this game. I love this game. I know Z loves this game, and I know Dan loves this game. The negativity isn't about beating up FFG. It's the same reason that a lot of people are beating up WWE. It's you want it to be better. I want to see this game, honestly. I want to see it overtake Magic. And right now, with Magic doing all the shady undertones it's doing, is a perfect time for FFG to strike. And I wish they would be kind of maybe a little bit more aggressive with that. But it's not about knocking them to knock them. It's not about being negative to be negative. It's about, I think this is where you need to head. I think this is where this game should go. I've never been one to kind of take the status quo and be like, well, I'm happy they're giving me anything. No, like I want it to grow. I want it to be big. I want to see 500-600 person vault tours. I think that would be great. That's just me. It's about trying to make it better, and we know they listen. So there's that. Dan, time for uncomfortable questions. Are you ready?
What? I don't get to talk about what changes I think this podcast needs.
Oh, sure. Go ahead. Yeah, go ahead, Dan.
I don't think it's that bad. I'm here now, so I'm trying.
Oh,
to
Oh, Dan's
keep your,
here now, so it's all good.
Your poor factual research in check. So, you know, like that was your problem. You didn't like to look up things.
No. And what's funny is, you know, me and Z always used to talk like throughout the week as things would go. And you see that now, like we'd have a game plan of where we're going with things. But then all of a sudden, like the conversation would take a turn. And then we decided at one point we're just not going to do numbers anymore because we pull them out of our ass and just kind of make them up as we go. We're like, yeah, we're not going to do, let's just not do numbers anymore because we're real bad at it. Because it's not because we're not factually checking them. It's because, crap, this wasn't on the agenda, so nobody looked it up. Do we really want to take the time to sit here and go, let's look it up real quick? No. And we just never did because it was, I feel like it would have, I think we both felt like it would have screwed up the flow of the show. So maybe, you know, one of those things. But, Dan wants to know, Dan, oh, you can't see my screen. Never mind. Dan wants to know, how does it feel being the worst player on the podcast? Pretty good. I enjoy it. It's all right. You know, the other guys beat me up and make fun of me and trip me and call me names. But, you know, hey, it's all right. Dan also would like to know, I heard you like wrestling. Can you tell me less about that? Sure can. And is it true you vape so you can disappear in a cloud of smoke? Yes, it is. I want to kind of just sink back and disappear so nobody can see me and go from there. Also, banana hammock or commando, I'm going to give you all the bad, since most of you have seen me by now, I'm going to give you all the bad mind image of Wookiee in a banana hammock. So you're welcome. Ketchup or mayo. Is there a both option on this one, Dan?
Mayo.
Oh, yeah.
I like ketchup and mayo.
No, there's not.
No, there's not. I got to choose. So if I have to choose one condiment, it's either ketchup or mayonnaise. I'll choose ketchup. Ketchup is more versatile than mayo. I can't put mayo on a hot dog, but I can put ketchup on a hot dog.
You don't put mayo on hot dogs.
Yeah, really? You can definitely do that.
I don't know. That seems strange. I don't. I wouldn't do it. I couldn't do it.
I mean, meat, cheese, and mayonnaise. That's my hot dog. Onions.
And cheese?
Yeah.
Oh, I don't like cheese on my hot dogs, but that's me. Which creature do you wish they made into a gigantic mutant version of itself? It's either Bonesaw or Gnarp. Because I love them both. When's the last time you played a game of Keyforge? Wednesday, Dan. Just Wednesday.
When we forced you.
You didn't force me. I was planning
on
coming.
And I'm pretty sure you played like a two-year-old.
Yeah, no, I totally did. Because I've already told
He sounded drunk. It was pretty good.
Well, I told you, like, the reason that I play in the dailies is one of two, really, it's actually normally just one reason. It's so somebody doesn't have a buy, because buys suck. True. Nobody wants to be a part of a buy. So if there's six people, I'm not going to be like, well, somebody's got to take a buy because the Wookiee's got to play. Like, that's not what I do. I'm in there because, you know, there's a potential buy, and buys suck. You got to figure out something to do. And a buy at home, of all things, like, ugh. That just sounds horrid and terrible. I don't want to do that.
In person, honestly. Like, at home, you're at your computer, you can play a game.
I suppose, but, I mean, what can you really get done in the matter of 35 minutes?
What? Okay, I mean, so I guess that question... That question was posed before Wednesday. So can you name your game before Wednesday?
No.
That's what I thought.
No, I couldn't. Because
of course, we can ask that same question to Z, too.
Right, but of course...
I played a game yesterday, jerk.
But before Ooh. Before yesterday. Before yesterday, though.
Shut up.
Because, you know, the only like I said, the only reason I play in the dailies is when there's an odd number, and then I'll jump in and play. I wish I could play in more, but it just so happens we have, like, it's always 8 or 10 lately. There's never, like, 9 or 11.
I was shocked, though, when I logged in. I did play a game yesterday. I was on the Crucible. There was, like, 6 games going total. That's really low.
I haven't seen it that low.
I've never seen it that low. What time would you log in?
It was like midnight, like 1 a.m. or something.
Oh, okay. Because I was going to say, during the day, like right now, you're not going to find many games on there.
There's 30.
Is there 30 right now?
Mm-hmm.
But like at night, like towards like 6, 7 o'clock, you see quite a few games going on there. So I don't know. Maybe you were just in an odd time.
Definitely I think be. You're going to see the numbers go down right now because Mass Mutation isn't live.
Oh, yeah,
we didn't
that's
talk
true.
About that much, but like Mass Mutation potentially might never be live, or if it is, it's not going to be.
I thought it was live.
No, it is. It is not.
They have those fake decks.
They did just post, and I haven't watched the video, but they post about them working on it. So they're working on it. The answer exactly on how icons are going to land on decks hasn't been done, but there is going to be something, I think, in place to do that. It may not be right, but there will be something in place. But, I mean, like, I think we all saw, and you saw it in deck registrations, when AOA went live on Crucible, that helped that set significantly in sales. And the same thing, I mean, it's going to be 10 times worse with Mass Mutation, because you can't play them at all unless you're online, really. So if TCO doesn't get it on, it's as bad as that sounds. I mean, that's really going to hurt the game if TCO doesn't get it up in a reasonable amount of time, and they're third party nonprofit. So like, it sucks that we're counting on them that much, but it's great that they're working on it.
Currently, this is their message. It says Mass Mutation decks will not be able to be imported until the site MM update launches. We're working hard to make sure this comes as soon as possible.
So they're waiting on it to go live in.
I think this is referring to their own internal site.
Okay.
Correct.
They would have officially. They did not reference the Master Vault database, which is the real issue.
That's what I was going to say. So are we waiting on the Master Vault?
I think they must be working on some code to randomly assign their own enhancements for all imported decks. I doubt they'll ever change by deck. I doubt they'll be, like, I don't think there's any way they can be accurate, as Dan said. But being able to play these decks in any fashion is of high value to all of us that love the game.
And let's see, did you have anything else? No, that was the last one. When was the last time you played Keyforge? So. That'll do it for the AMA, at least for this time round. Want to thank everybody, obviously, for their questions and going into that, except for Dan. Dan, no thank you. No questions. You guys got anything else before we get out of here?
No, I'm going to be playing some Keyforge this weekend with some old friends, and that's it. Keep playing Keyforge. Enjoy your Mass Mutation decks.
Mr. Dan?
Nope, thanks for the questions. We are still running dailies. As soon as Mass Mutation goes live, we will probably run a short series of Mass Mutation sealed stuff just to get that going. Otherwise, just keep playing Keyforge. I get to go play some real Keyforge here again on Tuesday, so I'm pretty excited in a very controlled environment.
Yeah, they didn't ask me, so I don't get to go play.
You had the potential COVIDs, man.
I just
you
told
stay
you,
away.
I tested negative.
Well, now we will reconsider the hazards of allowing you to
the
come.
The tribunal will come together and we shall decide your fate.
We have to do our hazard analysis.
Yeah.
Decide what critical controls we need to put in place.
Understood. All right, guys, that's going to do it for us this week. We'll figure something out. I don't really know what we're going to be doing next week. Maybe we take a break next week. I'm not sure yet, but we'll figure something out. We'll have maybe some mass mutation games under our belt, and we can talk a little bit more about it. Anything else going on? Don't forget, you guys can hit us up at archonscorner@gmail.com for questions, needs, comments, concerns. You can also go to the Discord channel, which is you'll find the link down below. It'll lead you right into the Discord channel. You could find Dan there where you can complain about all of his questions to him right there and then. And we'll go from there. So we'll see y'all next week.